we praise the Lord no matter what circumstance we're dealing with. Anyway, here's Rindy.
Hello. My mom actually wrote this song. I've sang it at church before, but you might think the words sound kind of funny. She wrote it in a hard time in her life, and I think that no matter if you went through the same situation she did or if you're going through different ones, we can all sort of relate to feeling down, feeling depressed, feeling hopeless, you know, a little bit. But if you give it to Jesus, then He can truly amaze and overtake you and make things better. So.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Rindy. Uh-oh. Can't see anything. Here we go. All right. Hope everybody's doing all right after that song, man. I almost started tearing up there. Had to hold it back, keep my composure. Anyway, let's go ahead and open with prayer. Father, we love you and thank you. Truly, thank you for today. Thank you for all your blessings. Thank you that you are so good. Thank you for everybody who has tuned in to watch today, Father. They're expecting, Father, they're expecting something from you, something good from your word. I ask that you pour into them through your spirit. Father, speak to them. Let them get something good that will help them right where they are and right what they need, Father. Please let it be so. In Jesus' holy name, amen. All right. Today we're going to be talking about how the devil attacks. Man, I tell you, and it seems like sometimes he doesn't stop attacking. Can I get an amen out there? Anybody feeling me? I feel like I've just been continually being bombarded by attacks, like an onslaught of just warfare. And that's true. The closer you get to God, the more you're going to be attacked. Expect it. Know it's coming. It's always right around the corner. And that's why we need to be prepared for those attacks, because they are coming. And he's only going to attack those who he sees as a threat. Matter of fact, last night, I couldn't sleep. And usually he does hinder my sleep on Saturday nights. He wants to hinder the message that God is wanting to bring forth on Sunday mornings. So a lot of times I see those attacks happen the Saturday night, leading up to the service, leading up to the message. But then God allows the devil to do his thing, but then God takes over and God does his thing. And it's so beautiful. If you are in God's will, God will use you despite those attacks. In the midst of those attacks, in the midst of the storm, God will use you. And it is so beautiful. But when you are serving the Lord, if you're not receiving opposition, there must be something wrong. Because the devil only attacks those who he sees as a threat. And will do so by a volley of different methods. He will use all kinds of things. Anything at his disposal, he will throw it at you. He will try to stop you from doing what God has called you to do. He will try to squash out that plan that God has laid out for you. He will try. But if you stand firm and if you fight back, you will be successful because you are on the Lord's side. And that's the winning side. That's the best side to be on right now, I'm going to tell you. No matter how bad it gets, if you are on God's side, you're on the winning team. If you like being a winner like me, that's the team you want to be on, God's team. All right, we got to get into the scripture. The scripture tells us not to be ignorant of his devices, his schemes, his traps, all right? 2 Corinthians 2, 10 through 11. Now whom you forgive anything, I also forgive. For if indeed I have forgiven anything, I have forgiven that one for your sakes in the presence of Christ. Lest Satan should take advantage of us. If we are trapped in unforgiveness, he'll take advantage of that. For we are not ignorant of his devices. God doesn't want us to be ignorant of his devices or his means of attacking us. God doesn't want us to just willy-nilly walk around in warfare, having bullets and bombs going off all around us, and we're just walking out in the battlefield oblivious to our surroundings. God doesn't want us to be that way. He wants us to know the situation, to comprehend, okay, this is a spiritual war,
So I must train as a good soldier for the Lord. I must recognize that atmosphere that I'm in. I know that I can't see the war, but I know it's being waged all around me. So I'm going to take things as it comes, and I'm going to recognize that and not be ignorant of the devil's devices, schemes, traps, and so on and so forth. All right? And one of the things he trips us up on is he makes us think that it's always the natural that we're dealing with. That there's not a spiritual realm out there. That there's not any demons and things like that out there. That's just whatever you see is that's all there is. There's no other spiritual realm out there. And you don't have to worry about the devil because he's not doing anything. That's one of his greatest schemes. One of his greatest tricks is making us believe that we're not actually dealing with the devil. We're just dealing with other people. But listen to the scripture. Ephesians 6:12, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places, or in the atmosphere, in the sky. Not all the way up in heaven where God is, but the heavenly realm is also, there's two other heavens. There's three heavens, actually. There's the atmosphere, which we see as the sky. That's the first heaven. The second heaven is space. The third heaven is where God is. All right? So the devil is control of the powers of the air, which is our atmosphere, and all the way up to, you know, the sky and all that. But the devil is allowed to attack us, and he does so through other people. One of his main methods is he's using other people to attack us. He tries to get somebody that you know to hurt you. It might be a friend, it might be a family member, it might be a church member, it might be somebody in your town, it might be somebody in your country, who knows? But the devil will use anybody he can to try to bring you down. And if he can, he will. So don't let him, folks. Stand against him. Fight against him. Know who you're really fighting. It's not against that person. It's against the devil and his demons, all right? But one way he will try to attack you is he'll twist God's word, and he will tempt you, all right? He did that with Jesus. Let's go to Luke 4. Then Jesus, being filled with the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, being tempted for 40 days by the devil. All right, so this is something I want to show you here. A lot of times we think about the aftermath of the 40 days, but he was actually being tempted by the devil for 40 days, all right? We don't know all the ways that he was being tempted, but we know that Jesus was fasting. We know that Jesus was not eating, so that's hard in itself. But it says, in those days he ate nothing, and afterward, when they had ended, he was hungry. After those 40 days of not eating, he was very hungry. Can only imagine. And then the devil said to him, if you are the Son of God, command this stone to become bread. He's trying to tempt Jesus, all right? If you are the Son of God, just turn this stone into bread. That ain't a big deal. But Jesus answered him, saying, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but every word of God. You reading your Bibles out there, folks? We can't just live by natural food. We got to have the spiritual food as well. We got to nourish our spirits. Go read your Bibles. All right? But he's trying to tempt Jesus. All right? That didn't work because Jesus quoted the scripture. I wonder if I should do that. I wonder if Jesus did it. I wonder if the next time the devil tempts me, if I should use scripture. You sure should. That's your sword. That's how you fight back. Don't just let the devil keep shooting at you with all his arrows. You fight back. You swing some blows at him. You use your sword. You use scripture. But how do you use them if you don't know them? You got to crack that Bible open. You got to study to show thyself approved. You got to read and know the word. That way when those battles come, because you don't know when they're coming because we're in a war. But when they come, if you've already been training, boom, pull that sword out, shoot that scripture at the devil, stop his attacks, just like Jesus. Then the devil, taking him up on a high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a moment of time. And the devil said to him, all this authority I will give you, and their glory for this have been delivered to me, and I give it to whoever I wish. Therefore, if you will worship me, all will be yours. He's trying to tempt him with this glory and power and wealth, all right? And Jesus answered to him, get behind me, Satan. He gets fired up. He gets mad. We might have to do that too. Get a little mad about it. Get behind me, Satan. Leave me alone. Stop messing with me. For it is written, but you got to quote the scripture or else it don't do any good. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. Only serving God. See, Jesus knew how to fight the devil. Boom, shooting scripture at him. Throwing that sword out. But the devil ain't done. Sometimes you got to hit him more than once, all right? Because the devil's relentless. Then he brought him to Jerusalem, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, the high tippy-top point, and said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down from here, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you, and in their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. And Jesus answered and said to him, it has been said, he's quoting scripture again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. Quit tempting God. There's a lot of us out there who tempt God. Oh, nothing ain't ever going to happen to me. I'm just going to do whatever I want. Wrong. Don't tempt God. You got to use your noggin sometimes, folks. Use a little common sense, all right? Now, when the devil had ended every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. He realized, I can't get him right now. Because he's been fighting me with the word. He knows his word. He's been hitting me every time I tempt him with something that ain't working. So I'm going to leave until an opportune time. I'll come back. See, the devil ain't done with us. If he attacks you and you withstand him and fight him off, he's not going to say, oh, wow, he won the war. I won't ever attack him again. Wrong. He'll come back whenever you're weak and vulnerable. That's when the devil attacks. You see, Jesus was already weak and vulnerable. He had already been fasting for 40 days. He was hungry. He was vulnerable. And the devil said, all right, here's my chance. Came at him. Didn't work, though. But he didn't wait for he doesn't wait for an opportune time for you. Not when you're at your strongest. Not when you've been prayed up. Not when you've been reading good. It's been when you've been drifting away from God. It's when you've been stopped reading the Bible. It's when you stop praying as much as you know you should. It's when you stop praising God. That's when the devil creeps in. Ooh, he's at a low point. Now I'm going to get him. See, that's why we should make sure we're always prayed up. That's why we should make sure we're always reading the Word of God. That's why we should make sure we're always praising God. So that way, if the devil does attack us, we're at our strongest at all times. To the best of our ability. I know that we still make mistakes and we mess up and things. But to the best of your ability, always be ready. Always be ready. Because you never know when it's going to come. But you know it's coming. So you better be prepared, folks. But he does lie. The devil's going to lie to you. Any way he can, he's going to lie to you. John 8:44. You are of your father to the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. He's talking about the Pharisees here. But nevertheless, Jesus is relaying a message to us. He's letting us know, don't be like him. Don't be like him, because he's a liar. So don't be a liar. Because the devil's the father of lies. And if you're telling lies, you're taking part in him and what he does. Don't be a liar. You tell the truth. Now, there's a nice way of doing it. Sometimes you got to tell the truth, and it's going to hurt somebody's feelings regardless of how nice it is. But you tell the truth. Don't ever waver from that. You can have everybody around you mad at you for you doing it. But you tell that truth. Because that truth is something that God wants to come out. And the devil don't want that coming out. And the devil's going to send his attacks when you do tell that truth. But you keep telling it, regardless of the consequences. You may even lose your own life, like Jesus. He told the truth. And people hated him for it. And sometimes they just were so fired up and mad at him because he just would not stop telling that truth. and you be exactly the same way. You follow after Jesus' footsteps, and you tell the truth to the best of your ability. And let things, let the chips fall where they may. Let it be what it is. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be, will be. If people are mad at you, they're mad at you. If they love you, they love you. But the only one you need to worry about pleasing is God. You're going to make man mad, but you make sure you please God. You make him happy. You make him happy with what you do. And you might have to say a truth that is hard for somebody to hear, but you got to do it to walk in God's ways. Because he is calling you to do that. To expose darkness and fight against the devil's lies. And sometimes that's hard to do, but you got to do it. And then the next thing he does is he will attack you in your mind. He will attack you internally. 1 Peter 5:8-9. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him. Fight against him. Don't just let him attack you. Don't just be overcome with sin or temptation when he sends it. You resist it. You fight against it. Be steadfast in the faith with God and his ways, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. All right? God's telling us to be sober-minded. He wants us to be protecting our mind. He wants us to make sure that we are looking out for our mind. All right, there's another scripture in Ephesians that talks about having the helmet of salvation. Why do we have a helmet for our heads? Because the devil's going to be trying to attack you in it. He's going to be trying to attack you from the inside. He wants to make you think evil. He wants to put evil thoughts in your mind because maybe you'll go along with it. And sometimes he gets us. But know when you realize, man, I don't know about that thought. That thought doesn't sound like it came from God. That thought don't sound like it's righteous. I rebuke that thought in the name of Jesus. I am not going to let that thought take root in me. I'm not going to dwell on that thought. That thought does not line up with the Word of God. So I'm not going to think about it. I'm not going to let it be in my mind. And I'm going to put my helmet of salvation on and block it out. I rebuke that in the name of Jesus Christ. You might have to say that over and over. The devil might be continually hitting you and bombarding you in your mind. Oh, you're worthless. Oh, you need to do this sin. Oh, you need to hate that person. Don't forgive them. Whatever it is, I rebuke that in the name of Jesus. Nope. Mm-mm. It might be a lustful thought. Nope, not going to think that. It might be anything that has to do with the sin and evils of this world. But you don't accept it. You don't have to. Just because it's a thought entered in your mind, don't mean you have to keep it. Don't mean you have to take ownership of it. No, you get rid of it. I reject that thought in the name of Jesus Christ. And you get rid of that out of your mind. All right? Because the devil's going to keep putting them in there. He's going to keep attacking you there. But you just keep fighting him off. You resist the devil. And you be steadfast. You be strong. Nevertheless, the devil's going to come at you with friends and family. He did with Eve to Adam. Remember? He didn't go to Adam first. He went to Eve to get to Adam. You go back and read in the book of Genesis. Then, Job. He got to Job through Job's friends, Job's wife. He tried to get Job that way. Then, Peter to Jesus. Let's check that out. Matthew 16:21-23. From that time, Jesus began to show to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. Can you believe that? The audacity of Peter rebuking Jesus? Give me a break. Saying, far be it from you, Lord, this shall not happen to you. But he turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. He knew who the true source was. He knew that Satan was trying to use Peter to get to Jesus. See, it wasn't Satan coming directly to Jesus. Remember? Remember back when he was tempted and fasting? The devil came directly to Jesus that time. But now he's thinking, okay, here's that opportune time. Let me see if I can use somebody that's close to Jesus to get him not to do what God wants him to do. The devil will do the same thing to you, so you be watching out. If somebody in your family or one of your friends tries to bring you down or get you to do something that's sinful, you realize who your true enemy is. You might have to rebuke Satan, all right? Get behind me. Get away from me, Satan. All right? They might be looking at you shocked, hey, but I guarantee you'll get them to leave you alone. Nevertheless, know who your true enemy is. All right? The devil might also use those people in your town, the people that know you around town. Matthew 13:55-58. In this, is this not the carpenter's son? This is his townsfolk speaking about Jesus. Is not his mother called Mary? Is his brothers James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas? And his sisters, are they not all with us? Where then did this man get all these things? So they were offended at him. But Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. Now he did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. See, they knew him. And sometimes it'll be that way. People are like, well, I know you. I know what you've done. I know your sins. I don't care what you have to say, you hypocrite. Been there. I know your past. I don't want to listen to you. And that's what it came down to Jesus. They were like, I know who this guy is. I grew up with this guy. Who do you think you are trying to tell me how to live? And then that's what Jesus was saying. You know, there's not a prophet is not without honor except in his own country and in his own house. Meaning other people show him respect, but the people that know him, you're just old Joe Blue down from the block that I knew all these years. Who cares what you have to say? And he wasn't able to do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. Who do you think you are? But it doesn't matter about that because God can use anybody. Doesn't matter about your past. God can use you. And who cares what somebody else says about you? They may speak all manner of evil against you. Who cares? As long as God's behind you. As long as you're serving God and doing His will. Who cares what anybody else thinks? Your whole town might come against you. Who cares? Who cares? As long as you're doing what God wants you to do. As long as you're on His path. Those people in your own country might come against you. John 5:16-18. For this reason the Jews persecuted Jesus and sought to kill him, because he had done these things on the Sabbath. He healed somebody on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, my Father has been working until now, and I have been working. Hey, God's always working and moving. Therefore the Jews sought all the more to kill him, because he not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Some people are not going to understand the message that you have to bring. Some people are not going to understand it. They're going to be so caught up in their own delusion that they're not going to know what God is trying to do through you. That's okay. Don't worry about what their opinion is. You know that you're doing what God's called you to do. And you stick with it. You stick to your guns. And you don't waver. You be steadfast. The devil will try to use them people to try to bring you down. But you don't listen. You listen to what God's telling you to do. And it might make the whole world even mad at you. Who cares? If God told you to do it, you do it. And you listen and you obey. And it might be even to your own detriment. It might be to your own death that you have to do this. But you be obedient because God has a great reward for you in heaven. All the persecution, all the negativity that you've had to face will all be worth it. But you have to stand strong. Don't let the devil's attacks bring you down. You be the man of God or woman of God that He has called you to be. And you will have to be in a storm sometimes. You will have to be in the thick of the battle sometimes. But you stand your ground on the Word of God and the truth that God has given you to do what He's called you to do. And regardless of what anybody else thinks. Everybody's got an opinion, right? The only opinion that matters is God's, because His is founded on fact and truth. Let it be so, Lord. The devil will also attack you with sin and things of this world. 1 Timothy 6, 6-11. Now, godliness with contentment is great gain. Be sure to be content, folks, even if you're stuck at home. Be content. For we brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. And having food and clothing, with these we shall be content. If you got that, which I know you got a lot more than that right now, be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation and a snare. Who's setting the snare? Who's setting the trap? It's the devil, all right? And into many foolish and harmful lusts, which drown men in destruction and perdition. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil, for which some have strayed from the faith in their greediness and pierced themselves through with many sorrows. But you, O man of God, or woman of God, flee these things. You don't be like the world. You flee from them and you stay away from them. And this is what you pursue instead. You pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, and gentleness. You pursue these things. Not lust, not sin, not the world, not what the devil wants you to follow after, but you pursue the things of God. And you will be content. You will be full. Matter of fact, it says, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness shall be full, shall be filled. You will get filled if you hunger after the right things and thirst after the right things. But if you're hungering and thirsting for all those things, you'll never be full. Because guess what a millionaire wants? Another million. Guess what a multimillionaire wants? A billion. And guess what a billionaire wants? A trillion. And so on and so forth. And you can never have enough if those are the things that you try to fill you up with. Because you will not be filled with the things of this world. You can only be filled with the things of God. And you will never truly be happy or joyful until you can learn to be content with the ways of God. If you try to find anything else other than God and His ways and His word, you will never be filled and you will never be content. And you will always have this longing inside of you. You will always have this void inside of you. And it will never be filled until you put the right things in it. Because God put that longing inside of you for Him. But the devil tries to twist it to make us pursue the things of this world. Because he knows if you get that desire in your heart and you start falling after the things of this world, it will be a path leading away from God. And the only way you can stick with God is sticking with Him and His ways. It's the only way. I'm telling you right now, don't fall into the devil's traps. This is how he attacks you. So we know this, so don't do it. So if you know it, power is knowledge. All right? Knowledge is power. 2 Timothy 2, 22-26. Flee also youthful lusts, but pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, with those who call on the Lord out of a pure heart. This is what we need to look for. Other believers. Get connected with other believers. All right? But avoid foolish and ignorant disputes, knowing that they generate strife. And a servant of the Lord must not quarrel, but be gentle to all, able to teach, patient, in humility, correcting those who are in opposition. The devil's going to come at you hard, and he's going to try to get you to get in your flesh, but you try your best to be humble. You try your best to be gentle. Try not to fight with others. You may have a disagreement. You can state your opinion. Have the last word. You can bow out. Hey, you want to keep arguing? That's okay. I'm gone. I'm done. You can argue with me all you want till you're blue in the face. I've said my piece. I'm done. I'm out. I've tried to teach you. I've tried to be patient, but you're not listening. I'm out. But you do have to correct those who are in opposition. You try it your best with humility. If they won't listen, that's between them and God. You leave it in God's hands. If God perhaps will grant them repentance so that they may know the truth. Maybe God will give them a chance to repent. And He will. He's very merciful and He's very forgiving. And He wishes that none should perish, but everybody come to repentance. and that they may come to their senses, so they can, I was in my flesh, and escape the snare or the trap of the devil, having been taken captive by him to do his will. Some people don't even know it. Peter didn't know it. I didn't know. Peter didn't know that he was doing what the devil wanted him to do. He just thought he was trying to get Jesus not to die. But he didn't understand the things of God at that point. He didn't know that God's plan was greater than what Peter wanted. Sometimes man has his own opinion about things, and I think it should be done this way. But God is saying, no, my ways are higher than your ways, and you need to learn to trust me. Lean not on your own understanding, but on what God is calling you to do. Right? All right. Sometimes the devil will send something directly to attack you in your flesh. 2 Corinthians 12:7. And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, God was giving Paul a lot of revelations here. A thorn in the flesh was given to me. Something, some problem that he had. Some think it might have been something with his eyes. Who knows? But guess who was behind it? It wasn't just a problem that happened out of nowhere. It said a messenger of Satan or a demon was sent to buffet or attack him, lest he should be exalted above measure, lest he should be puffed up. Oh, God is revealing all these things to me. I'm so awesome. But God allowed this to happen. God allowed the devil to attack him. And the devil did. And it was something in his flesh. Some kind of physical ailment. And we all deal with ailments, folks. It might be an ailment from the devil. You never know. But that's how the devil attacks, all right? But nevertheless, God gives us ways to fight back. It's not all about just the devil attacking us and us just having to stand there and take it. No, he says he gives us weapons to fight back. Listen, 2 Corinthians 10:4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or fleshly or of this world, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds. Our weapons are not literal swords or guns and weapons of that nature, but they're spiritual weapons that we use to fight against the devil. And we kind of know what some of these are, and I'm going to tell you that in a minute, but James 4:7 says, therefore submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Anybody want to see the devil running? This is what you got to do. You got to submit to God, all right? Submit to him in all his ways. God, here I am. Use me. I'm willing to obey your will. I want what you want, and I'm going to obey you. If you say it in the scriptures, I'm going to do it. That's how you submit to God, all right? It's not some kind of half-hearted, lukewarm thing where, yeah, I'll serve you on Sundays, but the rest of the week is mine. I'll do whatever I want. No, it's not that. It's full submission. Here I am. I am your willing vessel. I want to be used by you. I will do anything I got to do for you. If you tell me to walk into a room with men with AK-47s and preach the gospel knowing I'm going to die, I will do it to my own detriment. I will do it to the detriment of my own family if that's what you've called me to do. And you cannot be fearful and scared of the outcome because God knows what he's doing. You got to step out in faith and just trust him. Don't lean on your own understanding. Well, this could get bad. Who cares? God told me to do it, so I'm going to. Make sure you've heard from God, though. But nevertheless, when you resist the devil, he's going to flee from you. Whew. There ain't nothing better than seeing the devil running from you, I'm telling you. But this is how we fight back. We fight back with the name of Jesus. Jesus is a very powerful name. Use it. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. That name of Jesus has power in it of itself. If you can't remember anything else, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Devil, demon, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. You fight back with praise. The devil can't stand it. You're being attacked. You're surrounded with problems in the storm. I praise you, Lord. I praise you. He can't stand it. The devil hates praise. With prayer. You got all these attacks. God, help me. I don't know what to do, but I just pray for you to help me. God will send the help. And then you fight back with the word of God. You fight back with just how Jesus did. When the devil sends the temptation, You don't just take it. You don't just succumb. You don't just do what the devil's trying to tempt you to do, but you fight back, you resist, and you use that word of God. Which is, and in Ephesians 6, go back and look through Ephesians 6, 10 through 20. It talks about your pieces of armor, but one of those pieces is a weapon, and that is the sword, which is equated to the word of God. You've got to know how to wield that sword. That means you've got to study to show thyself approved. You've got to be in the word of God. And don't just read it every now and then. You read it daily. Take up that bread daily, that daily bread. Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That's how you will be nourished. That's how you will fight against the devil. That's how you're going to be sustained. That's how you'll be a great warrior for the Lord. You read that Bible. And if you can't read the whole thing, you just try your best to read the New Testament as much as you possibly can. You read that New Testament as much as you possibly can, as much of it as you can get in you. If you haven't ever read the Bible, you read that Bible. And you learn how to fight in the spiritual warfare that is waging. And folks, trust me, this is the end times. There's a lot going on that we don't understand, but there is that spiritual darkness that is out there and wickedness. And we need to be the light in this dark world. And light exposes things. Light exposes darkness. And the quickest thing people used to think was light. People think that the speed of light is the very fastest thing that there is. That's not exactly correct. The fastest thing is darkness getting out of its way. Darkness fleeing from the light. You be the light. God has called you to be the light. And light exposes. Light reveals. You be that light. You reveal the truth to those who need it, despite of what it may happen to you. Despite that, and you will be a strong warrior for the Lord if you do these things. Know how your enemy attacks and know how to fight back. Don't just be a weakling Christian. Don't just be a weekend warrior. You be a every single day warrior for the Lord. And if you don't know how to fight, you go back and rewatch this over and over. And if you need more help, I'll be happy to send you some good stuff. But you learn how to wage a good warfare for the Lord. And I trust He will help you, and I believe that He's already been helping you with these truths. Anyway, God bless you. I'm going to go ahead and close in prayer. Father, thank you so much for today. Thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you for speaking mightily and boldly through me, Father. Let it be so for all of us. I appreciate you. I appreciate you being with us. I do not take it for granted, Father. Help us through this time, and help us to gain some truth from your word. In Jesus' holy name.